Welcome to the Rebel Love Show. We are a once-a-week broadcast from Manchester, New Hampshire, where we are pro-pot, pro-gun, and pro-coffee. You can find all of our contents at rebelloveshow.com. I am Ron Mathias.
And I am the Rebel Mistress.
And today we have the NH Hempfest crew in the house, guys. How's it going?
Always a good time. Always a good time. Yeah. Rowdy crowd tonight. So we got the one and only Rick Naya.
Hey, Mr. Naya.
Yes, sir.
And can you introduce yourself?
I am Stanley Kuligowski.
Kuligowski. And then, of course, we got Tom.
The famous promoter, Tom Brown.
Tom Brown and?
Me, Lori Morris. Hi.
How's it going? Lori Morris, so to the directors.
We got a full house tonight. So we like to open up the show, you know, just wondering how everyone's week's been on a lighter note. It's been quite a crazy week, I feel like.
It's been a crazy couple weeks. We haven't been on the air in a couple weeks. So.
Yeah, we were just lazy last week, and we were feeling tired. We went on a long hike, and it kicked our asses.
Yeah, we saw all those pictures. They were wonderful.
Oh my God. You go to Franconia Notch, too?
Yeah, we did. We actually did. I went to Franconia Notch throughout the week. A few times in the past 2 weeks, I've been through Franconia Notch. It's just a beautiful, beautiful area.
Yeah, we're definitely getting into
it. That's my first time hiking up there, too.
It's phenomenal.
We like to hike and trip on the mountain.
Yeah. Every hiking trip we've done this year has been a hiking trip.
That's the best.
He brought the dog, and he enjoyed his stroll too.
He loves it. Riker, he's a great
Riker
hiking dog.
Is like the he's the best hiking dog. Like he goes around with us the whole time. Oh yeah, he doesn't leave our side.
Yeah, he like he gets scared for us. He's like, can you guys hurry up, please? But yeah, other than that, I mean, it was a pretty fun week. There was some like crazy stuff that happened. It was a lockdown. Like
our neighborhood is literally locked down, like right down the street, a block away from us for like 12 hours.
Yeah,
we saw that guy that shot the police.
Yeah, apparently he shot some police or something, and they caught him at like 5 a.m. supposedly, but they had our street shut down until like 12:30, helicopters flying around, and it was a bunch of questionable activity going on.
Yeah, pretty exciting for Match Vegas.
I know, and then... Yeah. So, ironically, the same thing happened in Laconia. And
yeah,
then
the same day.
Well, yeah, the same day.
The same
day.
And
really
they put them in a shelter in place warning. So, I mean, the week was fun and all with the hike, and then it got kind of scary, like police state-y, like, oh my God, like I thought they caught this guy. Now they're like, they're telling me they can search my house at any time. I was like, damn, I don't know what to do.
It was really weird because, like, they didn't even. They said they captured the guy like at 6 a.m. and like the entire neighborhood was like locked down till like almost 6 o'clock at night.
People were taking pictures of like the pointing like AR-15s in their cars, and I don't know. It was just like a lot of shady stuff going on that day. So.
Wow, let's put it on a light note. At least a few weeks ago, when all this was going down, we had a chance to visit with our sponsors, ITEL Hempwick. And they sponsored Robbie Krieger at the Flying Monkey, and we were invited to be up there for VIP, and we got a chance to meet the legend Robbie Krieger, and it was quite impressive. ITEL is really something else. We're really proud to have him as a sponsor, and we want to give Art a big kudos for that, and thank him very much. And also, last week we were able to negotiate with Laconia Fest.
Yeah, I saw that. It was like a co-sponsorship.
Really big news for New Hampshire Hempfest.
Is that a motorcycle rally?
Well, yeah, it's during Bike Week, and you know,
nice. I didn't know they did that in the north.
Well, if you want news about Bike Week,
Laconia Bike Week's like going on.
Bike Week, Tom's the guy because he's been doing this for over 20 years. So, Tom, take it up on that note.
Yeah, Bike Week is the second largest motorcycle event in the world.
And Sturgis is like the one above it, right?
Sturgis is the biggest, yes, and it draws in between. Actually, they can't really measure the attendance, but it's approximately about 500,000 people over 9 days to Weir's Beach, Laconia, New Hampshire.
Yeah, and after 20 years, I think last year, Laconia Fest started, and they took the Weir's Drive-In over, and they did a rock concert for a number of days, and it went so well that this year they did it again. And we partnered up with them. I extended myself to them, and we told them, hey, we're New Hampshire Hempfest and Freedom Rally. We're the original. And we'd like to team up with you and sponsor you guys and have you guys sponsor us. And they agreed to it. So now we've got a really good extension of the family. And all of New Hampshire's citizens know that not only is Hempfest, we believe, a family event and a statewide event, but so does Laconia Fest. And it really brings a lot more people to the cause and a lot more attention to both sides. And I'm really proud to have Laconia Fest supporting us that way.
Nice. I think it's very interesting that this year We're getting into a lot more festivals ourselves, just like in the festy scene. And it's always great networking opportunities because everyone in the festival scene seems to be a lot more open and just like wanting to know about other events. So that's super cool. Are you going to any other festivals this season to market yourself to, or
oh,
market
boy.
Them? Or
yes, actually we definitely are marketing ourselves. We just printed 20,000 postcards. And our flyers will be at this weekend, the 420 Rally, the largest in the world in Colorado. They will be at Dome Fest this weekend, which is Pigeons Playing Ping Pong event. They will also be at Mama Strawberry's event in New York. And they also will be at Germination in Harmony, Maine.
Also, we'll have them at Strange Creek next weekend. We'll be there. And another
nice.
Thing, too.
We'll all be there.
We'll all be there at Strange
Creek.
Yeah,
we'll all be at Strange Creek. But let's bring this one into the United Unity Cypher and the East Coast Cannabis Coalition. We took the East Coast Cypher, that five-foot-long joint, from Maine all the way to Miami. We also sponsored our posters. We gave our actual event poster and our Freedom Cup poster to have everybody sign, and it went all the way down. We're bringing that back up and raffling that off this year for the Laconia Food Bank. And also,
wait, you're raffling off the cipher?
No, we're raffling off the actual posters that were signed.
Oh, that's cool.
And they're really quite unique. They're one of a kind, first of the world. It's never been done. So they're a very unique piece of history for anybody that's a collector in the cannabis industry. And there's a whole bunch of other different things that are going on that we're going to be doing that weekend. And you know, like Tom was saying, all the events have our posters. All the events around the region know who we are. Also, another big key critical thing this year that we were awarded by Cannabis Now as America's Best Marijuana Events of 2016, New Hampshire Hemp Fest and Freedom Rally claimed number 8 spot. So for us, that was a really big deal. We didn't really know where it came from, but to be honest with you, we really do give it our all. The cause to us means so much. And there's so many events going on this year. Mile High Pain Management Products will be there with Matt Kipp, and he's got a really big event going on. We have Palliative Group that'll be there sponsoring us as well. Looking forward to having them. Our sponsorships are growing, 420.com. We have an insurance provider that'll be there as well. Everything just continues to grow every single day by leaps and bounds. And it's amazing to know that the people in New Hampshire are finally stepping up and realizing that, you know, we've had enough, and this event is, like I keep saying, it's like a teeter-totter. We're neither the teeter nor the totter. We're the fulcrum. We're the people in the middle. So we don't take sides. We don't judge anybody. We're about love and giving, and that's what we're trying to do, to bring awareness to the cause through love and giving. And that's what this year's event's theme is going to be, love and giving. And another thing we need to remind everybody, and please remember this, everybody that comes through our gate must bring a canned food, or you'll be asked to go to the corner market and get one. Because we're doing a large food drive for the Laconia Food Bank and for the Lancaster Community Food Bank and the community of Lancaster. So remember that, everybody. Bring a can of food.
Is that a custom with like other festivals? Is that something that other festivals do as well?
It is. It's very a custom. Actually, there's an organization that was at our festival the first year, which was Strangers Helping Strangers, and they go to festivals across the whole country doing food drives, which is great.
Yeah, because I've never seen that as a as something that's been done before at other festivals. So,
but that
I'm
is
excited
awesome.
To see that.
And yeah. Like I was going to say, it's not just that you're talking the talk. You're actually walking the walk, but not just with the food bank, with other marijuana activism that you've done. I mean, even the Unity Cypher, I feel like that was history making. The success of the 420 rally, like it was
amazing.
It was so great. And I think it'll be even bigger next year that
Absolutely.
You're on board with it, trying
awesome.
To help it grow.
Absolutely.
And then just recently, you know, even your appearance at the, the ATC Sanctuary. Okay, we're going to have to talk about it more when we come back. Medical marijuana people. How do we get a card? Rick's going to tell us.
All right, guys, for those watching on YouTube, I'm going to play a little bit of The Heavy Pets for you. Hope you guys enjoy. They will be playing at NH Hemp Fest. So go buy your tickets, nhhempfest.com.
told me I was wrong. So I wasted all my time. You know I waited for way too long. Now I need you to
help me, help you.
That's true. Say, I won't promise anything to you.
Help you.
Welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. Before we went on break, we're talking a little bit about medical marijuana. Sorry, not marijuana, cannabis. Always try to remember to say the right words. And I found this very interesting because, as we all know, right after 420, they did not pass decrim.
No, the House passed it, but the Senate threw it down.
Yeah, MAGA Hussein, right?
Then the House pulled it back off. And they went back over it again, and it's going to be reheard. So anyway, we were talking about the Sanctuary ATC opening up a few weeks ago.
Yes.
Yeah, we made a lot of history there. There were a lot of people there. There must have been about 100. A lot of people.
Were you first in line?
Nope, I wasn't first in line. There were people there about 7 a.m. waiting. It was awesome. When we got there, there was a lot of people
and
there.
And where is this? Can you tell us, like, where is Sanctuary ATC?
Yeah, it's in Plymouth, New Hampshire. They have their grow facility in Rochester. They were the first in the state's history to get their permits and able to begin the grow, and got their occupational licenses to hand out the prescriptions. And yeah, we were there. Joseph LaChance and I were there. There were a lot of other dignitaries that showed up. Was very happy to see Jason Sidman.
Is this something that you've lobbied for?
Oh, I've been doing this for about 6.5 years. I didn't start it all, though. You got to know that I stepped into this with Matt Simon, Erica Golter, Rennie Cushing, Ted Wright, Joe LaChance, Adam Schroeder, Glenn Aldrich. There were a number of others that I'm missing, and I'm sure of it. Linda Horan, who passed away. There was a lot of people in the forefront, quite frankly. But what they were doing, were lobbying, and they were doing the best they could to get through to the people there in the House and to get these measures passed. And it wasn't working out. It didn't seem to be working out, and that's where I kind of came in, again, as the fulcrum on the teeter of the totter. I didn't play any of the games. I didn't want to get involved in the House. I didn't want to do that. I wanted to share the love of the community, the love of the people of New Hampshire, because that's what I found at the first event. And when I went there, I was touched, because remember, I come from the other side of the railroad tracks. I didn't come from the festival scene. I got to see it firsthand, and it touched me. I got to see, wow, these are real people. This is a voting block. These are real, genuine people. And that's what really got me going. And I started talking to the people, my reps and friends, and the next thing you know, I invited them out to the first, my second, the year that I took over and began the executive directorship of the event. And they decided to say, hey, look, it's kind of scary. I don't know if we should go. And I'm like, please come for me. You know me. Please come to the event. I'll show you. And when they came, they were just in awe. They were all stricken like I was. And it's grown from there. Things just keep blossoming. The doors and
so
avenues
with,
keep opening.
With medical cannabis, yep. How many dispensaries are open in New Hampshire right now?
Just
right
one,
now, there
right?
Are, no, we have two. We have Sanctuary TC and Temescal have opened. We
Lebanon,
also
Lebanon just opened.
Right, the Lebanon office has opened as well. So
I wonder how much regulation is in. Do you guys know anything about the amount of regulation it takes to open a cannabis dispensary medically?
Well, even what we did in the state here is they had an application that had to be filled out, and it was a process with a committee that was formed through the state, as well as the general public was part of it. And we helped write the RSX and the rules and the regulations, and back and forth it went throughout the years. And finally, the applicants were chosen through a committee there at the DHHS. And hold on. And DHHS nominated the three that had won, and that was Sanctuary, Temescal, and Prime. Right now, Sanctuary is open. Temescal has opened their first one, and the one in Lebanon. They have two different offices.
Dover.
They have one in Dover and one in Lebanon.
Yes.
Right, that's right.
So I was wondering about a medical marijuana card for my anxiety. And
well, that is not on the list yet. We haven't been able to get
that
to be on the list.
Okay, so that was my next question. So what do I have to do, or I need to qualify?
Not on the list yet, but it should be on the list.
Yeah.
Right. Well, we have to understand that it takes years to get what we have on the list.
Can you tell me what's on the list?
I think I know most of the things.
Okay, let Lori go over that, because she too is a patient, and she's also got her card as well as I. So this is Lori Morris. She's our executive director assistant of New Hampshire Hempfest and Rena Rally, and also a patient of Cannabis of New Hampshire's program.
Yep. So I just got my certification on Friday.
A little bit closer to Mike.
Marijuana card. I just have to send in the money to get my card, but there's a list that you have to be a qualifying patient. Kind of like you have to have like these qualifying things, like a back disorder
or injury,
which is what I qualify for, spinal injury. Okay.
Okay.
And then there are other things on there, I believe. Like I think PTSD is on there now.
Nope, not yet. That is not one of the things on the list. What are on the list is like coxia, glaucoma, HIV syndrome. They have
brain damage.
They have brain damage. Is one of them seizures?
And cancer.
Epilepsy. Yep.
Okay, so my second question about this is, so someone with one of these disorders, like, can they just ask any doctor to recommend them for a medical card?
Well,
or
they can try. That's the problem that we're facing.
If you have a doctor, that's what I want to know. I've been going to the same doctor for the past 8 years, but because of things that have happened in the past with pills and things, I didn't think that they would want to help me. So I never bothered to ask him. So somebody had told me about Palliativity, so I just called him up and I talked to him. They're wonderful people.
Oh, they are.
And
wonderful.
I went up there, they will do anything to help you.
What's it called? I'm sorry.
So it's called Palliativity, and it's in Bedford.
What is it?
It's called Palliativity.
Palliativity is the name of it.
Yeah. And they're in
Bedford,
New Hampshire.
Well, Lisa Withrow is, I believe she's an RNP, and she's very good.
And
so they helped me.
Harmony Wellness.
All right, let me share now. Palliative Group and Palliativity is an office that's in Bedford. They're one of our sponsors. And what they do is they're an alternative treatment office. And what they do is they take your information, whether you have back problem or any problems that you might have, and they go through you for a three-month process, because you have to have a three-month relationship with a doctor or a specialist before you can get recommended. Remember, it's a recommendation. Everything's recommended. So if you meet the criteria of the qualifications and the list of ailments that you have, and you have a relationship with a doctor that approves that cannabis is be good for you, they can fill out the form. Right. The state will review it and determine whether you qualify. And if you make those qualifications, you get your card. If you don't, they send you a note and say you need to do this or that or fill this out. There's a reason that aren't clear. And then your doctor will redo that. That happened to me, quite frankly. And I was the first handed it in. So it took me a little bit longer to get mine back. But anyway, I did get my card. And it's not as hard as you think, but Palliativity Group is, if there's people out there that need to find a specialist to help them, and their primary care doctor is willing to have them do that, talk to your primary care, have them contact Palliative, and discuss this alternative avenue for you to see if it's going to help you with your conditions. So that's kind of how it works, you know.
So it's, well, go ahead, baby. No,
I was just gonna say it does seem kind of hard. I remember the last time I went to the doctor and he asked me if I smoked cannabis, and I was like, yeah. Then he was like, how often? I was like, not that often. He was like, give me a number. I was like 5-6 times a week.
That's funny.
No, I was lying.
Okay, what's the real number?
Like 10, 12 times a day.
A day?
I never. When they ask me, if they ask me, it's only like, no, but I don't let them know.
Welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. We are live on LRN.FM and IPM Nation. YouTube feed went down for a second, so I'll have that up at rebelloveshow.com/live. And also, we are taking Skype calls. Skype username is Rebel Love Show. Skype in and see if you have a question for the Hempfest crew.
Yeah,
and about
Skype
Hempfest.
It in,
please do.
So before we went on break, Rick was going to tell us about the foundation that he is starting.
Yeah, we are. We're starting a foundation. It's called the New Hampshire Cannabis Foundation. We have a number of select people for chair and trustees right now. We'll be releasing all those informations and data. And the foundation basically is being established to not only help support and give legitimacy to our cause, but to our New Hampshire Hempfest and Freedom Rally. Tom and I have always had that vision, that we knew that it had to get to that level, because so many things get said by so many people that they don't believe what grassroots is, and they think that it's all for our pocket, when they don't realize it comes directly from our pocket. It's from our efforts. None. There is no money. It all goes directly into bands, venue fees, costs, overhead, and if which we have to say thank God, because we have good management skills, we have run our event every single year and broken it right at the egg. So what we've done is we've managed ourselves literally to the INT just to get by, and we have grown. When I met Tom, the event page had 1,380 people on it, likes. After the first year of me being involved, we grew 4,280% to over almost 11,000 likes. We became one of the nation's best venue events. We've brought in people from all over the country to help us grow and expand. So we knew we have to be able to manage ourselves at that next level. And by doing that, it's by becoming an endowment or a trust or a foundation. So that's what we're doing. We're establishing New Hampshire Cannabis Foundation to help direct the event. Not only the event, we're going to be working with DHHS. We're going to be working with state agencies to help established rapport between the doctors and the establishment to make them more aware, to bring the technology, agricultural, medical aspects into the realm of the discussion for the economic aspects as well. The foundation is a lot more than that as well. We want to be giving. So our foundation is a lot about love and giving, just as this year's theme is love and giving. We want to help in a very compassionate way. We want to help children, and we want to help veterans. We want to help those people who are indigent that can't afford the expenses of these medicines at these alternative treatment centers.
It's a shame that, like, this – I wish we lived in a world where you didn't have to create a foundation to do this.
Well, is your foundation going to be like a 501c3?
Okay. We're going at it. It's a legitimate company. I mean, I'm sorry. It isn't even a company. It's a full-fledged foundation. We're doing it all in charity. It's all for charity. All the money that we generate and are able to generate through donations and through our events that we co-sponsor and that we develop will go directly to grants that we're going to be giving to people who will send us letters and videos about their cause and what they need. We're going to help the alternative treatment centers by helping fund them to help grow cannabis for these indigent people and help offset the cost for DHHS. We're going to take this initiative to help the state where we need to, the people that need it the most, and we neglect them. So we know that this foundation, the first of its kind in the state, is a very legitimate one, and we're very proud to take the helm. And when we do release the names of all of the trustees and the chairs, I think that the state should be very proud of who's taking this helm and where we're going to guide a newer New Hampshire in the direction that the people truly want.
When do you see this project completed? Your foundation up and running?
We will have the foundation completed before the event kicks off. We'll have a
Before Hemfest?
We'll have our banners flying at the event, yes.
Oh, okay.
Beautiful. Wow.
So we'll be on radio. We'll have plan in action.
We'll just have shit here, people.
We'll bring the chairs here one of the evenings, and we'll sit down and talk about it. We'll do a kickoff, and we're really looking forward to this. This is one of the biggest things that can ever happen to not only our cause, but for the state. Because, again, we're the full.
Oh, are you going to have like a mixer for your foundation?
What?
A mixer.
Yeah. A mixer?
Yeah, to introduce your foundation, like cocktail mixer.
Wouldn't it be like a pot mixer?
I don't know what type of mixer we'll have.
Both, obviously.
We'll do a proper foundation grand opening, let's say. We're going to do a proper. We'll probably do it at the Marriott or some big, convention center. We'll have dignitaries from all over the state, industries from all over the country and the region. This isn't a joke. You guys have to realize when you're nominated at the 8th best event of its kind in the nation, we take it very seriously. And, that's
what we do.
Hopefully you're number one.
Who put out that rank?
That would be a very difficult thing to do in New Hampshire. Well, considering this.
I have high hopes for HempFest, and I think this year is going to blow everything out of the water for next year. Like, how are you going to even top it?
Let's remember this.
They're going to be like, oh, my God, can we go back?
I got to give a rundown right now. We have to remember something, that we're always making history. But let's just start out. We're going to have the largest wedding in New Hampshire state history.
Yes.
We also have the very first Freedom Cup in New Hampshire state history, the very first Bake Off in New Hampshire state history, the very first New Hampshire HempFest and Freedom Rally pinup girls. We have the very first, largest in New England ever UV forest, and you guys aren't going to believe.
And it's at Rogers Campground.
Yeah, and it's at the Holy Land.
And is at the Holy Land.
It's at the Holy Land.
You guys have to know what they mean. When you get there, you'll know what they mean.
The UV forest will be awesome, made by my buddy John Ball. Yeah,
Johnny Ball.
He's doing it.
And Jeremy Sparks. I want to give a big kickoff today again to Jeremy as well. We have a new DJ coming on, Bandicook, that's going to be playing, and he has a tremendous following up in this region. This cat's really tough. We'll be posting up about him and giving an announcement about that today. He's got a great following. We hope his fans show up as well and enjoy the splendors of New Hampshire HempFest and Freedom Rally.
I'm excited about it. The fact that when you're talking about the UV forest and like all the different the lights we're gonna have, like what's his name, the art director?
There's gonna be a vortex
tunnel.
We have laser lights. Listen, what you have to understand,
John Ball.
This has never been done. We have like 12 DJs. Half of these DJs all have their own lasers and lights and all these trippy things that they bring them back and forth to the clubs. Well, they're bringing all of their lights and they're hooking them all up with a company called Little Village, Lucian Emerson. These guys are the guys that do all the light shows for the big, big, they call it immersive environment. The type of light systems that they hook up are three-dimensional that move, and the lights move with the music and get your body moving with the lights. It's not like lasers flashing and going on and off. These things that he makes truly move. It's an exciting new type of technology that they're using. In fact, they have to have like 5 or 6 laptops and use 5 or 6 different programs because there isn't anything like it. That's wow. How cutting wow. edge our UV and our stage lighting will be this year.
I'm excited to see the art just in general.
Like, yeah. We have a superb.
The art is really going to be amazing this year.
Just based off the cover poster, like the art seems amazing.
Well, let's just talk about the art first and go over to Tori Minor. Let's talk about what we've done with a new art director this year. We have artists from all over the nation that are going to be showing up with their arts and their wares. We have live artists which paint while the band's playing and paint the band as they're playing live, and live action as people walk around the festivities, they take and they draw live paintings. We also have...
Not to mention we'll be having live body painting too.
Oh, we also Ooh. Have live body painting again this year, which went off very well last year, and quite tastefully, quite frankly. It was really well done. I got to give them kudos for that. Thank you very much, Ginger Rogers. And bring your dome too, Gingy.
I also would like to let everybody know that everybody that missed our Up in Smoke ticket special, we put tickets on sale for $75 Up in Smoke starting yesterday until this coming Sunday. So for one more week, everybody out there that just didn't have that $75 for a ticket,
this is your chance
to get a great deal on a ticket.
Get your tickets now, folks, while they're last.
Right. I just wanted to touch base earlier.
We'll be right back. Hold it. We're going break.
Hold that note.
Hold it.
Don't blow any load yet.
Phenomenal.
Come on, baby, light my fire.
Okay, YouTube.
Plus,
I got the live feedback, so if you're watching at rebelushow.com/live, it's up and running. My humblest apologies. I don't know what's going on with Google Hangouts, but it crashed on me. And the bumper should be going, but our other PC crashed. Not a good night tech-wise. I can't believe I actually got up and running. Anyways, I am going to throw on a...
He goes like this.
I'm going to throw on, let's see here, the McLovins. They are playing at, they are playing this year at NH Hemp Fest. Go buy your tickets. They're only $75 right now. Well worth the cost.
Yes, we will, Mr.
I'm ready.
They do your thing, though. We definitely want you to talk. That's why you're here. We want you and Lori to talk. So.
That's my only one. So did they have a bass player?
Yeah.
Give me the news. Ain't got time for all this bullshit.
Tokyo tea on ice. She knows just what she wants and she sees what she can't get and she's not surprised. Fine. No, she can't stay loose. No, we're not this time. No, she can't stay loose. No, well, not this time. Come on, keep kicking with the new. Come on, keep kicking with the new. Ain't got time for all this.
That you want to read off.
Right.
And welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. We're here with the Hempzest crew, and they're awesome as always. So since we're on the subject of Hempfest, since we last talked, are there any updates, or can you just give us a refresher on some of the performances, the guest speakers, what all you got going on, you know? You told us about the EV Force, which sounds awesome.
Do it, Lori. Go for it.
So you want me to do it?
Yeah, Lori, go. Come on, girl.
All right. So, I will tell you the late night.
A little bit closer.
We're going to have some late night DJs. So, we're going to have Wicked, Midas, Milk Toast, Dosed, Mystic, K-Ped, DJ Slim Stanky, Shane Slaughter, Mr. Burns, and Joss Monster. Plus, there's going to be so many guest speakers.
Remember also who we have.
Who else?
Moondacog. Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Just go Bandicog.
Okay.
Can you turn it down?
I'm sorry, I was turning wrong.
Okay, and so those are the late night performers. What about guest speakers? Like, who else is going to be speaking?
We're going to actually have 17 famous guest speakers from all over the country.
Famous, you say?
Yes.
How famous?
Who do they begin with?
Satoshi.
The famous Tom Brown.
Yes.
Very famous cannabis activist.
Tom Brown?
Thomas Howard.
Yes.
Who's that guy?
And why is he famous for?
He's the promoter. He's the founder, yes, man. He's the beginning of it all. Without Tom, there wouldn't be a Hempfest,
exactly.
Period.
That's right.
And also Rick Nya. And you know a few porks like Glenn Aldridge. Are you speaking?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Stanley Kulikowski. He's right.
What are you doing?
Kulikowski. Can you tell us a little about like what you'll be speaking about, some of your background with Hempfest? Like, how long have you known Rick?
Well, I've known Tom.
Give us a shakedown.
For ages, and I do all the shows. I'm a vendor. I was a silversmith, a guitar player, and a keyboard player. I still play keyboards. I had a stroke 10 years ago that actually took me to the other side. It was a quick trip to the other side. They brought me back, and when I came back, my left side was completely shot. I couldn't stand up. I couldn't move a finger on my left side. And they made me sit outside the cafeteria with another stout fellow like myself and made us watch because we couldn't go in and eat with the other people because we couldn't swallow food. So I had a doctor. I have a general doctor. And they were 1,500 pills a month I was taking. Pills for everything. I can't even begin to imagine. Still no left side. Still I can't walk. I'm having a hard time with everything. I asked my doctor about medical marijuana. He wouldn't even talk to me. I knew about the endocannabinoid system, the system of receptors in our mind and connected to all our body. Homogenizes the systems of our bodies and heals. We can heal ourselves with the right combination of photocannabinoids. No, he wouldn't talk about it. So I did. Erica Galter, great woman.
Yep, my partner in New Hampshire. Absolutely. Norman, Erica Galter, yep.
She said, Stan, I'll tell you where to go. To go to Palliativity Medical Group in Bedford, New Hampshire. Yep. That's the company these two were talking about.
Lisa Withrow and Paul Withrow.
I got my medical card. It took a long time. I have to say that the medical program I'm impressed with. It's been a long time coming, and it's still. I'm still waiting. Merrimack's not going to be open.
Can you go to like the other ones? Yes. Okay.
And for me, if I don't get the cannabinoids in my system, I have terrible leg spasms. I can't control them.
And why do you think your doctors who vowed to do no harm wouldn't help you?
Wouldn't even talk about an endocannabinoid system. Looked at me like I was talking about reptilians underground or something. You know, and it's like, so then he went on vacation, and he had a young nurse there that did her studying in California. Yahoo, I said to myself, she'll know about endocannabinoids. Not a peep. Nope, they don't teach us anything about that. I know nothing. In the meantime, they want to give me start. I'm taking 1,500 pills a month. Pills for
that's crazy. I don't even take Tylenol. I could not even imagine that.
I don't take them anymore either. So they said, all right, we're going to give you shots of Botox. Four in your arm, four in your leg, 80 a year. On top of the Wilpinerol and the Baclofen and the Ativan.
It sounds like way too much to me, Stan. Way too many pills.
Versus a plant.
So I just looked at him and I said, no. I know about endocannabinoids. I know about what hemp does and what THC does and cannabidiol. All they are is molecules. It's like running the car without a voltage regulator. And as far as medical marijuana is concerned, it's not all medical. Every single bit, every time anybody smokes marijuana, it's good for them.
Yeah.
There you go. It's like, that's my daily
it's my daily vitamins. I got to stay healthy. I'm doing this.
Back in the day when our hemp farmers who grew hemp for a living was part of the economy. Back in those days, they thought tomatoes were a poisonous berry. And if you ate a tomato, your skin was going to, your blood was going to turn to acid. Now imagine if some righteous person back in that day said, that's it, tomatoes are illegal. It would cost $50 to fill up a bowl of tomatoes, and pizza would sell for $50 a slice. Well, Rick put a post on Facebook about a week ago. It says, well, if you eat 2 ounces of marijuana a day, it's going to be really, really good for you. It would be really good for you if you ate 2 ounces. No THC. You don't heat the chemicals at all, and you get the nutrition. It's not medicine. It's nutrition. It feeds your body and enables your body to do the things. So,
like, either way, it's not hurting anyone, so I should be able to use it any way that I see fit.
And teach your children well.
Ever.
Ever.
CBD deficiency.
No one's ever overdosed from it? Yeah. They call it a word that I don't like using, but I'm going to use it in reverse right now. It's a gateway away from opiates.
Yep.
And it's becoming a known fact. Even the doctors at Sanctuary ATC are stating it in public, and they know it.
It only takes a little bit of research to see the benefits.
We tried telling them this 10 years ago. I told them, you guys are overprescribing. What are you doing?
Yes.
And then they said, we got to slow it down. No kidding. You've got to slow it down. And then they said, we got to yank it. Don't yank it. These people are going to run to heroin. What happened?
They ran to heroin.
Bingo.
Yes. And now they have a bigger problem than they had before.
And now let's let them have residual. Let's let them be high. It's going to be okay. We're going to get through this.
But still, every day.
The problem that they cause, and let's be unreasonable. Let's think about this. Let's send the wrong message. This was the answers that they gave us about cannabis. Let's send the wrong message. That's what they're sending. They have sent the wrong message all along. And we keep trying to say this over and over again. Drugs is not a law problem. It's a compassion problem. This is something that needs to be dealt with compassionately. And by throwing people in prison, ruining their lives, taking away their kids, taking away their career opportunities, kids can't get college funding, it destroys families, it's not the route to go.
I mean, it just baffles me that every day the FDA is prescribing like oxycodone to 9-year-olds. Yes. And exactly. It's just like, yeah. It's like, are you trying to profit off
what
this
about
heroin
allowing
epidemic?
Oxycontin in? They allowed Oxycontin to be prescribed to kids now.
Yeah, as young as nine. As young as nine.
What are we
but
doing?
That's a doctor saying it's okay.
And it just
the FDA says it's good.
You got to read today what came out. Ha ha.
You know,
the people of the Oxycontin have been keeping their records sealed, and these videos and these recordings that they had. Well, guess what? Ha ha. They're going to open those records up. Any day now, we're going to find out a lot about this Oxycontin and really what it is and what's going on.
Yeah.
And we'll have a lot of answers as to why an epidemic has occurred in our country as
it has. It definitely leads to heroin addiction because you can't get the oxygen.
Cannabis leads you away from it. They didn't. Yeah. They have it ass backwards. And sooner or later, they're going to realize, whoa, we've been making these mistakes. We're the ones that are insane by doing this.
But if you ask someone like Maggie Hussein, she'll say, we're in a war. But she didn't say with who, so I'm guessing it's me and you that she's in a war with, and you can't just say a little bit of marijuana is okay.
Yeah, but here's what she when you're in a war, it's a health issue.
No, for her, it's a monopoly.
But you can
issue.
Obviously research the health benefits of cannabis.
Let's consider
so
that.
If you could like lay down your health issues in like bullet point format for me, then she could have a leg to stand on. But it's ignorance.
Right now, the battle is being lost on a federal level and a state level throughout the nation, just through science
a populist
and freedom
level.
Of information. This is how we're winning. We're winning with freedom of information, educating those of us that we elect. Our House reps and our senators truly listen. You just have to get to know what it's all about. New Hampshire has a greater value.
When we come back.
All right, guys, this is the long break. I'm going to play another band coming up at New Hampshire Hempfest. This is Wobble Sauce. It's a live video of them apparently from Boston. So let's check this out. Go buy Hempfest tickets at nhempfest.com. We'll be right back.
And welcome back to the Rebel Love Show. We got the New Hampshire Hemp Fest and Freedom Rally crowd. And we had Tom Brown going to tell us a little bit more about some performers and sponsors they're going to have at this year's Hemp Fest.
Hey, we want to give a big thank you out there to Halogen, Finish Line Performance, Palativity, New Hampshire Cannabis Foundation, Mile High PMP, Abel Ebenezer, Stone Girls, and also Ganja Printing.
I love Abel Ebenezer, by the way. I actually did a... I'm actually part of Foundation. I don't know if you guys know if I'm a part of a foundation as well. I'm part of... it's right here, Foundation for New Hampshire Independence. I'm a board member for that. And Abel Ebenezer held a... an awesome little shindig there for the foundation.
They're like the only beer that I like.
I want to tell you,
Abel Ebenezer's great.
Yeah, they are. The beer last year was fantastic.
Yeah,
they have really great brews.
Try their Auburn. That's all
they're a second year sponsor for us. This is our second year, and I want to thank them.
Yeah, awesome. I do too. Yeah. Yep.
Nice.
Yep.
And then weren't there like some fire spinning hot chicks?
Yes, exactly. they're called Luminous Fire and Flow. Not only are they fire spinners,
Rob's gonna put them
they're
on the street.
Acrobatics and hoopers too. They put an amazing show on. They'll be performing Thursday night, Friday, and Saturday, all three nights at New Hampshire Hemp Fest.
Oh my God, I'm like a hooper myself. But not fire.
They actually do fire eating. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, it's really fire unbelievable eating. Show. We tried to do it the second year. We had a bunch of hoop girls that came out, and they did their thing, and they got on stage, and I think it was more of a, let's go to Hemp Fest and hang out and throw our hoops around. This year, we have a true legitimate Las Vegas style show.
People are watching this on the screen right now. Yeah, these so girls look like fucking goddesses.
They are.
Yeah, if you go to rebelloveshow.com/live, I got some footage of these girls twirling the fire. It looks intense. They're swallowing fire now.
I dated a fire eater once.
Wait, when did you date a fire eater?
She was hot. I told you. They were carnies.
Do not. What? No. I do not remember you talking about fire breathing carnies.
Yes.
I do not remember this story.
Oh, wow. You don't listen.
Did she look like this? She was hotter than this chick.
Yeah, remember I told you she had a double nipple piercing?
Oh, yeah. The crosses. Yeah. Okay. That
See,
was her.
That's all you remember.
Yeah, that's all I remember.
That's it. See,
you have so many stories. It's really hard to keep up
Rebel
with you.
Rebel Love Show,
that's
which one online?
If you go to rebelloveshow.com/live, that's where you can watch the video live if you're listening to LRN right now or IPM Nation. We also are taking Skype calls. Skype username is Rebel Love Show.
Yeah, come on, somebody Skype in.
Are they going to be performing every night? Or?
Yes, they're going to be performing every night.
Every
which
night?
Is
oh, my God.
Night.
They should be at the end of the UB4 is just so, like on my like trip because I'm going to be tripping.
Actually going to be right on main stage.
Oh wow! Okay. Yeah.
Wow. During what band? Their own show, or is it going to be during?
They're
going to
have their own show at the very end of the night each night.
Oh my God!
Oh wow! Yes.
This is like entrancing. I'm so excited. I'm excited for Hempfest. Unbelievably, like I can't even tell you how excited I am because it's just
connecting.
It's so many great things. Like, I look down at this flyer and I see glow yoga. What the fuck? Farmers markets. Like, there's going to be everything. Like,
glow yoga, by the way?
Glow yoga is actually yoga at night in the dark while glowing.
Oh, do you
what
just
mean,
pour
glowing?
The...
You're actually, while doing yoga, whether you're a guy or a girl or whoever's doing yoga, I'm just kidding, but... You'll be glowing.
Yeah, you wear glowing paint or glowing clothing.
Yeah,
glow
you
could
just
yoga.
Pour. That's oh what we. I've done that once
yoga.
In the woods.
It's really cool. It's
you just
like
break the light up sticks that you have and pour the juice on people. And then
some
they glow.
People do that. It's kind of freaky. Yeah.
Well, we have some real paint actually. That's
oh,
because
okay.
the light up juice is, you know, I don't know. I don't know how good that is for your skin, but
probably
I think what's
not good.
Be really
but you only
cool
live
is
once.
Our UV
yellow.
Forest, man.
Yes.
That UV forest is. Amazing.
What's the name of the sculptor or the lightsmith guy who you introduced on your New Hampshire Hemp Fest page?
Emerson, the immersive arts expert. He is with Little Village.
He so is
Little
so
Village,
trippy.
And he's amazing, and he's done some great shows out there.
Well,
he's done all the lights and many concerts across the United States, like the Great North. Yeah,
he does gigs for Dopapod, Twiddle.
I know it's Krovacki through
it. Trippy.
Yeah, oh,
it's too trippy for.
He does Wobble Sauce.
It's too trippy for the green screen. But I mean, this art is just amazing, and it just I don't know. Like I feel like I've become a psychonaut. Like this. Past
I want you
year.
To know that the artists that we have. You asked about that earlier, and I want to bring them up. Yegor Mushishkin and Nate Ooh. McClellan. These are the artists that did the Freedom Cup and our poster and all of the work that we have. I met these guys at Rob Robertson's event in New York on a real trippy scene.
A real trippy
yeah,
scene.
Yeah, we really connected. And these guys did this online with me. So what you see a lot of, really, when you see their designs, Nate drew up all these little caricatures. And Yegor has the more psychedelic, in-depth kind of trippy kind of scene. So if you see our Freedom Cup poster, Yegor did that one. And what it is a culmination of me and him collaborating over the phone, my personal feelings of what I wanted in the cup, what I wanted the hands to do, what the banner should look like,
is
what
it
should
say. Is the cup finished? Have you seen the actual
well,
cup?
Well, that's another thing. We have Josh Holbrook, who was with Glass Hollow.
Who's actually making our actual glass cup, which will be awarded to some of the winners of our Bake Off and Freedom Cup.
Are you going
to
tease the cup,
it's
or are you going to like?
Right?
Is it just?
It's like
no one will know what it looks like until it's given.
It's like if you were to go to try to buy it, you'd be in the $500 to $1,000 range for this glass.
More than that, some of these glass works that they make
is
now,
it a mug amazing. Or a gauntlet.
Amazing.
Listen, just so you know, this artwork that he's making, they're pieces of art. Some of the types of pipes that these guys blow and make are worth $5,000 and $10,000. The glass cup that he's making, our overall championship cup. I put that way up in there, like $5,000, $7,000 range type cups. That's the kind of designs that we're getting made. Just so everybody knows out there, if you're going to enter the Freedom Cup, this is the first in history, these cups will be
worth
a fortune.
Aren't you a little bit like worried of the state coming down?
No, this is all private property. Just so you know, it's a public event. The minute you hit the gate, it becomes a private property, and everything that goes on there is for adults to make their choices. We don't condone, we don't say yay or nay, but adults can partake as they choose, and they can do what they like to do while they're there.
One word, it's called freedom. You know,
it's what it's about.
It is a freedom rally.
You have the freedom to do what you want to do. You know, wherever you want in the United States.
Yeah, as long as you're not hurting anyone else.
That's right.
Well, I only say that because like last year from Porkfest, there were tax collectors there going after vendors.
Well, we saw what that happened.
Yeah.
You guys chased those guys off like
a
pack of rats.
Today.
Well, I'm just saying that needs to be done now if that happens with
they also
police
saw
coming
all
there.
The guns and we're a little
Pork's the we are pro pot, pro gun.
Yeah,
pro
coffee.
So speaking of being pro coffee, what other kinds of vendors will be there? Because I want to make sure I can eat good all week.
And
we're going to have between 5 to 8 food vendors with a little bit of food. You know, a little bit of everything from like Mitch's Munchies, for example.
Yep, and we also have Shane Goodwin that'll be there with Goodwin's Concessions. They have their fried goods, and he also has a new trailer that, just so everybody knows, we sponsored and helped sponsor him at an event, the Goodwin's family gathering they had.
Fundraiser.
And that was at the, in Hookset.
Shaking It Trading Post in Hookset, New Hampshire.
Shaking It. And what's that fella's name there?
That would be Brian Bell.
Brian Bell. Brian Bell sponsored an event there. We had a great time.
Brian's a great guy. Yep. Great vendor, and he's got a great store there in Hooksett, New Hampshire.
Everybody should sponsor
Shaking It Trading Post.
They should hit Shaking It Trading Post. Right on.
I've heard great stories of that place before.
Oh, man, you need to go
word
down there.
I've never checked it out before.
He's a real hippie with a big heart. He wears his heart on his shoulder, and he helps a lot of people out with fundraisers, and he's a vendor just like me.
Cool cat.
Out there working every day.
Definitely New Hampshire cool cat. This guy's dynamite. Yep, right on.
Well, cool beans. I mean, I can't wait to see just the glass blowers for myself. We need a new bowl.
Well, we have jewelry, too. We have handcrafted jewelry being awarded this year.
Right, we'll have glass blowers.
Allie Ramelot. We're going to have Allie. We got to give Allie a little bit of kudo. Allie Ramelot is designing.
A variety of vendors. Bit of everything.
I know who you're talking about, and somehow I ended up being friends with her on Facebook, like, I don't know, like 10 months ago.
Yeah,
before HempFest.
Oh.
And like I've seen her post. I know exactly who this person is. Mm-hmm. She comes up in conversation probably like five or six times
She's
by
a
now.
Very loving girl. A lot of people love her. She's
I have
a great
yet to
vibe.
Meet her. I've yet to meet her.
She's got a great vibe about her soul. She's a very soft, loving girl. She went off to Hawaii for a few weeks or months. Actually, a couple months she's been gone, and she just got back, and she's getting back in the groove. But, yep, she's going to be designing some HempFest Freedom Cup necklaces to give away, and I can't wait to see those.
I'm really excited about that.
Tomorrow with the HempFest crew will come back. We'll be right back.
have a drum?
No.
We just go to a drum circle.
Who do you go do it with?
Emily, the girl who is one of the HemFest models, she set it up. She's from Utah where they have a big giant drum circle. It's like a great drum circle.
You need to talk to them and say, y'all come to HemFest.
No, they they're coming. Are. They all are.
Tommy, you hear that? We're going to have a huge drum circle.
Yeah, the drum circle. These are like pro. Like, our drum circle is intense. Like,
yeah, I know it'll be huge.
We got to talk about that. Ooh, ooh.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What else can we talk about? We get on the same vibe.
What else can we talk? We got comedians. We got to talk about our comedians. We're going to talk about Maggie Lenz and Kendall Farrell, two of the funniest chicks in cannabis industry comedy.
Whose idea was the girls, calendar girls?
Right.
Oh, I knew that. Good idea.
A lot of the best ideas come from this Coco right here, pal.
That was a good idea.
We've had some great ideas, and the girls helped too. We did, didn't we? We did a good culmination. Our biggest problem is now we got to get these designs to Tom's seamstress.
So Tom, is she like legit? Like, she's not gonna drop out, right?
She's two houses up from. She's my next door neighbor, and I've been friends with Linda for about 10 years. And probably about like 8 years ago, her ex husband moved out. And, she has like four kids, and they were all like she took all the ex-husband like was just mad and took all the beds, and all the kids were sleeping on the floor. And, you know, at that
can
time,
have that beer.
At that time, I had a bunch, extra beds in my barn, which didn't cost me much, and I just gave it to her. You know, and she's been, you know, sewing tent tops for me ever since. Stuff like that. She does sew, so she's really, you know, she's a caring person. She knows I care about her. And I don't think she's
the thing is she seems trusting enough to
receive our tweets. Big job. These girls, like, now that they're dropping out, bringing people to the ideas of liberty.
One got
more accountability. Like Lynn Jacobs.
You guys, you idiot.
We just need more accountability at this point. Well, so girls will be like, no, do they have to take it seriously?
Well, that's hard. She might be all right by August.
Who?
Who? Well, I mean, probably.
She'll be out to here.
Not always.
Ash is not gross.
Yeah, she'll be plump and not looking the same.
So we can tire you.
Those hormones change them, dude.
5 months.
That collagen changes their bodies, and they just change.
Yeah, I know. She's getting a little attached.
We'll be all right with what we have. We'll find the ones we need. Oh, it'll all be a blessing as it is.
We'll just look for someone with the measurements.
I kind of want to talk about Strange Creek.
She'll be the last one.
Yeah.
Did you know this right here, this post?
Which one?
We're 99 days away. 99 days.
99 days.
To HemFest, 99 bottles.
I'll do it if you
99
want.
Bottles of HemFest. Take
I lose track.
Pass, puff it around.
What's that noise you make when do it again? Wah, 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 or whatever.
Woohoo!
No, that wasn't that.
Wah, 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 wah.
All right, we're coming back in like a minute, guys.
Next time you make it. Close to that.
We need to close the door.
Yeah, we're coming back in like 30 seconds.
In Survivor Max 2, School Bites, Maximus scavenged through a wasteland swarming with the undead. Desperate to find the medicine he needs, he discovers a community of survivors at his former school.
Pay attention.
I know. Well, I hit 19, I'm like, oh, it's just like the minute just goes so long.
Yeah,
because
it's a whole minute.
I know.
The minute's always the same amount of time.
Do you love Twitter?
Now you got two.
Welcome back to the Rebel Love Show, and we were talking about HempFest and everything that's going on there, and I know I want to actually change it just a little bit, because I'm excited about kicking off the festival season with us all going to Strange Creek.
Yeah.
Like, I've heard stories of Strange Creek, of how great it is, but I've never been there before. It's going to be my first time.
Like, it's my first time, and I know, like, you don't go to a lot of festivals, Rick, because you just do your festival, and you're the man, right? So.
Well, it's not that.
Are you going,
remember,
Tom?
You have to understand something. It's not
normally
that.
I vend at Strange Creek, and I love Strange Creek, and I love the worms, but this year I won't be vending there, actually.
Why not?
Well, as a strange... strange thing, and you know, I almost really don't want to talk about it, but
let's
I will talk about it because nothing against Strange Creek, because I love it, and I, you know, Mark and Debbie, I've supported them for 20 years when Mark first started his festival years ago. And often with any festival, it doesn't matter if it's called Hemp Fest or Strange Creek or whatever the name is, you know, you end up sometimes with problems at festivals.
And as
a result of that, Strange Creek is not wanting people to sell pipes, pipes, or cannabis
glass pipes or
pipes from medical marijuana. They think that's going to fix their issue, and it's not going to fix their issue. The way to fix their issue is to basically say no powders and no pills, which Harry Brown has done for many years.
So wait.
Which basically means we don't want to see powders and pills.
No glass, no gases, no pills, no powders. Anybody looking like they're tripping on heroin, you will be escorted off the property.
Right.
Heroin? Wow.
Yep.
Yeah.
Those things happen all around the world, and at our event, that's not what it's about. We'll show the love. But we will escort
I understand, but was that, like, really a thing? Like, people
It's actually, you know, that brings
like,
a good...
the nitty-gritty of these festival people, and I talk to everyone, and trust me, I walk around the campground, and I make 16 best friends, and, like, never have I ever found someone walking around, like,
you don't see it too much at festivals, but, you know, to bring a point up, one of our DJs, he's actually a DJ in Dover, New Hampshire, and I want to give a big shout-out to Josh Mantra. Love you.
Hey.
He just put on a festival, which was a first-year festival, And it was for a cause, which basically to stop the epidemic in New Hampshire, which is, you know, unfortunately, medical marijuana hasn't been legal, and a lot of people haven't turned to it. A lot of people got addicted to opiates and, you know, prescription pain pills because they had a back problem. They blew their back out or whatever it might be.
Yeah.
And a lot of them have turned to street drugs like heroin, and they become addicted. And it's a big epidemic in the United States. And, you know, if marijuana was legalized and people use it the way they should be, you know, we've been lied to by the federal government for the last 40 years that it's bad for you.
Yeah.
I mean, look at the statistics. Smoking cigarettes kills 480,000 people a year. Alcohol, as far as drunk driving and crashes, kills in between 30,000 to 40,000 people
a
year.
And liver disease and everything else.
Those are the real statistics, and that's just mind-blowing. How many people died from overdose of marijuana last year?
Zero.
Oh, there might have been one. I think he got hit with a
That's
bail.
Because they want the control.
The bail fell on him, but that didn't happen. So, zero.
I mean, you know, Lori knows the story about that. Lori talk about her situation. Spin it, man. She's got a story to tell you guys.
So, hi. So, I injured my back 8 years ago. Going on 9, and so I've been going to the same doctor. And he wanted to put me on Percocets. But the stipulation was you have to sign a contract, and in that contract it says you cannot smoke marijuana. Well, I took one look at that, and I said, forget it. I don't want you to dictate to me and tell me what I can smoke marijuana or not. That's not your choice. It's mine. So
hear, hear.
I have not been on pills. I don't take pills. If I'm in pain, I'm in pain.
Absolutely.
I live with chronic pain every day, so it's nothing new. I smoke every day, though, too, to help it, to help calm it down, because otherwise I wouldn't be able to walk because my back is that bad. So I know all about opiates because, like I said, they were trying to be pushed on me, but I'm good.
Right on.
Well, good for standing up against that.
That's what I'm talking about.
Honestly, it's sad that we live in this society because they push them on everyone. Like, I got a headache. Here's some Oxy.
My throat hurts. Here's some Oxy.
I've
got my prescription card.
Like, it's just all, you know, they're trying to take the easy way out. And I do, like, commend you for, like, standing up for yourself because they will try to push it on you.
At the end of the day.
They did it to Stanley, 1,500 pills a month.
That's just crazy.
Yeah. Think about that.
How many pills do you...
Where you don't want to be on pills. How many pills
do you take now, Stan?
You know?
Six a day.
So you're down to around 200 pills, 180 pills?
Yeah.
Off of 1,200? And how do you feel? How is your health compared to the last? Do you feel more mobile now than you were before?
Well, cannabinoids come from all over the place. I use turmeric, echinacea, brown cocoa, natural cocoa, and green tea, and black pepper in a mix every morning. And that kind of calms me. That gives me the cannabinoids that I need, not the cannabinoids. Cannabidiol, CBD, that comes from hemp. Hemp for victory. On the subject, among the natural rights, some are by their very nature inalienable, and that is the inalienable right of conscience. And what kind of conscience is the state of New Hampshire exhibiting by keeping cannabis illegal to grow?
They're protecting their monopoly on alcohol. They don't want competition in the marketplace.
Well, that's where our foundation and a group of coalitions of ours throughout the state will be moving forward to make that, we hope, an impossibility.
And will you guys be lobbying more?
How are you going to make that impossible?
Or are you just going to donate directly to the cause
we'll be lobbying. That's what I'm going to be taking up. That's going to be my next big cause, not just our event. You know, I have children, have a life, but I am.
What's happening with hemp now, Rick?
Well, right now in New Hampshire, the state gave the opportunity for the university, because it was written in our statute to state that the university could do the study. And guess what? The university refused to do the study. Initially, they took it up, and then they turned it down, I believe, that they fear probably financing from the state and the feds, so they kind of stepped away and didn't want to do that. And we're going to have to go back and have a bill heard to bring that now to the opportunity of the public to do with a study.
So, right, and hemp is legal to grow in 13 states in the United States, last I knew, unless we've added a few, but...
Yeah, well, I'm hoping that New Hampshire does, because agriculturally speaking, it's an industry in itself, just the hemp products, let alone cannabis. Hemp and cannabis are two different types of plants. They produce different types of effects. One's more medicinal, other's more industrial. We in New Hampshire need to create industry. We have the technology base. We have a lot of intellectual children. We have a lot of electronics that we need to be practicing with and using that we don't. And a lot of the kids in our state get educated either here or abroad and don't come back to use those resources. A lot of the studies that we find all around the country is that, like in Colorado, Oregon, Washington, California, the kids stay. They get educated. There isn't a problem. They keep saying that the accidents, this is going up, that's going. It's not true. It's all false. Everything's continuing to go down. We have to realize that in New Hampshire and create a newer New Hampshire.
And it's still illegal, guys. You think about that. More when we come back.
Hemp Tax Act.
Uh-huh.
I know that in 1920 they founded the first drug FDA, DEA kind of a thing. I can't remember what it was called, but I do know also that in 1920 when Anslinger took over the department, that's when the hammer went down, because he was friends with Hearst, who made the papers, and with the DuPont family, who was doing chemicals and growing rubber trees in Mexico. And they just bought this huge...
Can you mute that if you're going to watch it?
How do you mute? That's when the hammer went down. What do you mute?
Oh, just mute the video. The right? Just mute the... Yeah, mute the YouTube video.
Okay.
There you go. That way it won't... Because it'll just keep going all the way in. So
right, but fine. I know how that progression went and how and what happened and how the name marijuana came into effect.
Mm-hmm.
That just came out, you know. I mean, the word's been out, but the guy that helped write that and knew all of why they were using these things as a discriminatory thing, and all that, he just came out with that not that long ago.
Wow. It's
pretty
crazy.
It's pretty crazy. He was like 90-something years old, and he told the story.
At the end of the day, it's just shocking to me.
It's shocking. It's discrimination.
Well, it's just shocking to me that, like, why don't people think that you should... You should be able to grow whatever you want. And you should be able to ingest whatever you want.
Anything.
I'm not advocating that there's certain things you shouldn't put in your body.
But
I agree with that. But I don't think someone should be thrown in a cage because they made the wrong decision. Like, don't get people on heroin need to, like, be in medical attention. You don't need to be thrown in a cage.
Fast food, McDonald's is bad for you. You put a McDonald's burger.
Tommy, you
too much,
stop
and I do
talking
eat it,
about fast
if you
foods.
You put a McDonald's burger. He, it, up, it'll look the same a year later. That's
Lori, tell him.
Hey, I used to be addicted
Tom
to
fast
food.
Tom is the junk food champion.
I used to be over 300 pounds. I lost 120 pounds.
Yeah, but you feed him when he's home. Don't you make sure he eats? I know you fucking do.
Stop at the grocery store, man.
Cooking turkeys.
Buy some groceries, just a little bit. Or like their pre-made sandwiches or salads or something. Go eat at least quick. Eat there first before you grab anything fast food. The only thing I'll get through a drive-through window is my Dunk's coffee. That's it.
Yeah, no, the fast foods are bad for you. There's not much that's good for you.
And even then, I don't get any sugar in it. I try not to eat any sugar.
It's the truth, Rick. Yes, Tommy, you do.
Either way, I think you should eat it, but I'm not going to arrest you.
Because, I told you you'd get hungry. So,
this is live now. Listen. We're going to be able to post it like you did last time, bro.
Yeah, but I'm going to throw up an edited version because I had some tech issues on my side. So there's two videos up on YouTube right now. So I'm going to make an edited version.
You said I wasn't going
to. I mean, if you want to share this now, go for it, but I'm also going to make an edited version to throw out.
I just want to give one quick little poem.
Yeah, we're going to come back.
Oh, good.
And, we're trying to get on the Rebel Love Show. Did you post this on our Cannabis Hemp Fest page?
Welcome back to the Rebel Love Show here at the Rebel Love Studios in Manchester, New Hampshire. We got the HempFest crew, and we can still take a couple Skype calls. If you want to Skype, the Skype username is Rebel Love Show. And you wanted to give you said you wanted to do a poem?
Yes, sir, I would.
All right, the floor is yours. Be poetic as you can.
Stanley Kuligowski, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, sir. Okay, well, first off, the laws against growing a plant. A natural
hey, if
water,
there is no victim, there is no crime.
There is no crime.
You get to decide what you grow in your backyard, and you get to decide what you can put in your
That's
own body.
That's right. When we give kings and princes and potentates the rights to tell us what we can grow in our garden, we're in big trouble. We're going to be paying $50 for a tomato, $100 for a slice of pizza. But anyhow, holy weed, bearing seed, reproducing its own kind. The Constitution of the United States promises we, the people, the right, the powers of the earth, and the equal station to which the laws of nature and the God of nature entitle we, the people, to choose the kind of medicine, the kind of food, and the kind of life we want to live. We're poisoning the atmosphere. We're choking the planet on carbon fuel. We're fracking the ground. We're being lied to, and it's got to end. It's an unconstitutional law. Congress can make no laws regarding the establishment of any one particular religion. By them denying me the treatment that I know my body needs, the nutrition I need to heal myself, and by forcing their medication on me, they are forcing their beliefs on me.
Well, I feel the same way about, like, I go to the extreme in regards to, like, the government, like, putting their views on me. If I don't consent, I don't consent. No means no.
Hear, hear.
You know, it's not just about the sex. And regards like anything else.
All interactions should be voluntary.
Yeah.
Right out.
You know, don't force. If you don't like something that someone else is doing, don't
That's
do
right.
it. Don't force your opinions on somebody
That's
else.
That's right. We all have to decide, and we have to figure out what's good and what's bad. And the first thing I learned when I had my stroke, I better learn how to wipe my own behind, because I know my lovely wife, as much as she loves me, she does not want that job. Wow. Ain't that right, Donna?
Stan, how many times, I know in your life you've had a few times that you were arrested for possession of small amount of marijuana, you know what?
Three times.
And you told them the exact same speech you just said to us now, and what did they say to you? What was the result of that?
They dropped the charges against me. Irwin Raven in 1968, went to court in the state of Alaska and said, you can't make a criminal out of me for cannabis. We have the right of privacy in our person or in our home unless it constitutes a public health hazard. There is a health hazard.
Yeah,
we're
but
not
they,
getting enough cannabis.
But they never follow their own rules. I mean, when does the government actually follow their own
they
rules?
They said,
that's
well,
ridiculous.
It was a gray law in Alaska. We all know what's happened in Alaska. I think it is legal there now, Rick. I'm not sure.
Yeah, they'll make anything legal in Alaska. They just want someone to go down there.
Just so you know, the Northwest, one of the biggest events in the country is in the Northwest is in Alaska, and that made the list of one of the best in America, too.
There's a festival?
I can get medical marijuana now if I go find a dispensary offhand. But I could never afford $400 for an ounce of.
I look forward to the day. How much is medical marijuana, and how much better is it than street marijuana?
I asked Rick that.
I'm sorry, cannabis.
Well, I'll share this with you. Being that I've been a grower for over 35 years, and I've done a lot of growing, the establishment right now is in their growth period, so to speak. And I think they'll get accustomed to the type of quality that we're accustomed to in the state, and they'll adjust and increase the varieties that they have and change them to the most current varieties, the ones that are here in the region.
Okay, because I want to say
the quality
this
is very good.
As a an immigrant to the Shire, New Hampshire, pot here sucks. Like I won't lie. Like
yeah,
I used to, pot was so great in the Midwest. I maybe think of it as better things, but I remember like
in Georgia
I could get
we
such higher
gas.
Better strands than I can get
like,
here.
Like in Georgia we called it gas because it was so strong. Every blunt you hit would like melt your tongue. Here is like eh.
Maybe it's because I built up a higher tolerance since
no,
I got here. That could be the case.
There's still
but
some good weed. Like
every once in a while you get a good strand from time to time. I won't lie, that's not the case, but
yeah, but I mean.
I mean, personally, I look forward to the day where we just get past medical marijuana and I can just, like, you know,
yeah,
every shop in the on the corner can sell it.
I should be able to order from my downstairs, like, store. Like, bring me an eighth up here. Mm. Like, let me know. Other than, like, because people
I want caregivers
look, do that.
I want my pot delivered by Amazon via drones.
Yeah.
All right? That's how I want it
in
to
bulk.
Be. In
I
bulk.
I want mine
well, it's because I don't think that, you know,
via the ground, via the sun.
Well,
we
absolutely.
Well,
I'm not a farmer, though.
Well,
like that's
have,
my thing.
Like, you shouldn't have to have all these conditions in order to get pot. I'm sorry. Exactly. It should be legalized for anybody who wants it and who needs it, regardless. Because
that's
people with anxiety and ADHD and PTSD that really need it, they're not allowed because they are not having a chronic condition or whatever they
the
want to call it.
The biggest problem we see with post-traumatic stress
it
disorder is because it's federal.
We shouldn't even have to pay for a medical marijuana card, as far as I'm concerned, because it should be legalized across the board.
Wait, you have to pay
absolutely
for the card,
yes,
too?
Yes, you do. It's $50.
So let me get this straight. I got to pay. Oh,
you
got to
pay $50 application
so
fee.
It's a step
exactly
in the right
wait,
direction.
Wait, is a $50 application fee and $50?
No.
Oh,
just $50
okay
for the whole thing.
And you have to renew it in the 11th month, not the 12th, the 11th.
It should be legalized, so you didn't have to. So you don't have to go through that. So the people who can't afford $50, who are in pain and need that, should just be able to go get it if they need it. Why should you have to have a medical marijuana card? It's stupid. You should just legalize it and
absolutely
stop and just get over it.
I mean, it's just the amount of research behind cannabis now is just like uncanny that it's still illegal. But I say that for things I go extreme too, like Rob. Like I say that for things like LSD and mushrooms, and like I feel like you know
well,
it should
just
be.
So you know,
unregulated.
So does the federal government. Just so you know, this MAPS, M-A-P-S, the Multi-Association for the Study of Psychedelics, was awarded like $3 million for the study of psychedelics, mushrooms and acids and so forth, for different types of psychoses and different problems.
I seen the article on that came out, and it
not
was
only
all
that,
positive.
Just recently, too, they were awarded to do a study with cannabis. So it isn't like we're lagging. What it is that they're lying. And here's how I can assure you of this. You can't have a patent without data and research done. The federal government owns 31 specifically for neurotransmissions and neuroprotectants and all forms of neuro studies. You can't get a patent unless you study this. And they claim that we don't have studies. We need to study more. We need more information. Yet, we own these patents. So everybody needs to know that they know. That's why slowly but surely they're releasing this, because I think they're afraid if they say, yep, okay, we're wrong, we lied, and we'll legalize
it
now.
It's like the 60s, that counterculture. They don't want that because then they can't control you. You're feeling too free.
Well, that's
you're becoming
like fluoride
too liberated.
In the water.
You're becoming too
fluoride
enlightened.
As sad as it may sound, the federal government knew back in the 1970s when Richard Nixon did the studies that
with Rafi Mushroom from Israel
was a cure for cancer. And it is a cure. It is a cure for cancer.
Cures don't sell. That's why cancer isn't cured.
I think of it more so, even more deceitful. I really view it as if like this is something that the government can use as a control. As like we're in power and we're gonna like we'll throw you in a cage if you literally have a plant on you.
Yep, that's
you
what
know,
they do.
And it's just crazy that so many people go along with that. Like that, so many people think it's morally just. Like you got the governor here in New Hampshire, that will
sending the wrong message.
So how long do you think till the federal government legalizes it?
How many years do we got?
That'll happen before Maggie Hussein.
I would love to say this is going to happen tomorrow. You know, the president has the power to take cannabis off a Schedule I drug and make it anywhere it wants to be. And the president has the power to do that. And he has, you know, I will say this much.
He's raid, dispensaries all throughout Colorado. You know, like, he's taken the drug war and, like, extended it far beyond what William Bush was doing.
He has. And, but you know, Barack Obama has done some good things. He has released, last count was about 68 or 70 people that were serving life terms. And it's not enough because there's...
We're going on break.
2 million?
The movement is on.
2,400,000 Americans in jail in the United States.
Is on. Right.
And a lot for nonviolent crimes.
Yep.
Who had a strain of pot. That guaranteed you 30% THC. Best pot you can get. But you can only buy Monsanto pot. Because they had the pot and they're going to... You won't be able to grow non-GMO pot, let's say. Would you smoke Monsanto pot or the dirt weed that we get here in New Hampshire? What would you do as a pothead?
I would smoke whatever I have access to.
That's some breakweed. Yeah.
And I didn't mean that, Rick. I didn't mean that.
No, I clacked it so, and it goes quack, quack, quack.
But what would you do? Monsanto is working on it. They're going to have a strain of pot.
Yeah.
They want control. They don't want us growing up. They want control. So... And it was way better.
The way I see it,
it's genetically modified. Like, first of all, like I said earlier, if it's not broke, don't fix it.
Was
like,
that your dinner?
What is genetically modified pot? Like, they're spraying that with pesticides and hormones.
What?
Me and I stopped and had something.
I'm not gonna smoke pesticides and hormones.
Yeah, Wendy's burgers.
I can't eat bread.
Yeah.
Well. I'm hungry.
And on top of that, like, if it's completely legalized, just like how there's a renaissance in beer, there's going to be a renaissance in pot. Like, there's going to be, like, you know, there's going to be all these little, like, farm stands and stuff like that popping up with all their own little strands.
Yeah, people are already growing strains just naturally. Like,
or do you need to be in bed?
The more technology,
like, it'd be like there's gonna be microbreweries, but of pot.
But yeah. I suppose you could order food for me, and then by the time
there's a Chinese place right there.
Right.
Is it any good?
Take Lori with you.
Which one? The one downstairs?
Yeah.
No.
I believe Rob.
Is there a pizza place down there?
Skinny's is good, but they're closed. I can tell you, all those places down there are gonna be closed by now.
They're all closed.
No, nothing's
open. The only thing that's open is like. Round the
Red Arrow.
Yeah, oh, Red Arrow.
Red Diner's great. Yeah, that's right.
The Red Arrow's.
Red Arrow's open 24/7.
24 hours.
Red Arrow's like the only open thing open 24/7.
6 a.m. They don't close.
No.
No, the Red Arrow's open 24 hours.
It's like the only thing in Manchester that is.
It's like diner food.
I'll ride with you so he can go take him home and he can meet us later.
Okay. Yeah, just order me food.
I will. Just tell me what you want.
We'll order for you, pal.
Yeah.
I always get their steak and eggs.
I tried their poutine the other day. It was delicious.
What was?
You do?
At Red Arrow. They got poutine on the menu now.
They do?
And get it with eggs. Oh, that was amazing.
With the gravy and the cheese. With the curds on it.
Yep. Have you ever had Chevachon? Chevachon is this, like, local French-Canadian breakfast place, like, one block away. They're only open from, like, you know, 6 a.m. to 3 p.m., and that's it.
For breakfast.
Just for breakfast. And they serve a little bit of lunch. They're absolutely amazing. Their poutine blew me away. They got crepes. Oh, my God, the crepes are unbelievable.
Oh, girl.
It's a French delicacy, a French-Canadian delicacy.
There's kid on here. He's been eating it like everything.
All right.
Dude, it's French fries and
we come back in a minute.
Cheese curds melted all over. In the
cheese curds?
That's delicious.
They're delicious. They're delicious. Well, I'm getting them. That's what I'm having for dinner.
I don't think I would like French fries with gravy.
Sloppy and good. That's what it is.
I'm sold on poutine. I'd eat it every day.
www.
Too much going on.
NHHempfest.com.
Is it going to remind you of the Kool Aid guy?
You can't hear that, right?
Want me to bring it back?
Yeah, you're bringing it back, baby doll.
You're rich. FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org. Remember when we were down to that a little
bit? And welcome back. to the Rebel Love Show. We're here with the New Hampshire Hymn Fest and Freedom Rally crowd. And yeah, we're rowdy up in here. So, guys, if you could just tell me, like, if you could just describe one, like, first of all, are you giving any giveaways or ticket
or
contests
like
to win tickets to HempFest, and you know, just say why should people come? Like, you've done a great job advertising, but what do you think is like the main reason someone should come to your event?
I mean, basically, you know, it's an experience of a lifetime. It really is. It's not something that just you go to a concert and go, oh, you know, that was great, and we saw this band and that band, and there was a little art and a couple vendors there. You're going to come out of this smarter, more educated.
Inspired,
yes. And not only that, you're going to listen to, you know, 40 amazing bands, 10 DJs, 17 political speakers, see 40 different artists, about 20 to 30 vendors, an unbelievable light show,
and just awesome people. Like, I feel like you can't discredit that, because I feel like that is what inspired me the most about HempFest.
You hit
last
it, girl.
Year is the people.
You
everyone
hit
there
it.
Had such great vibes,
the
and
vibes.
Positive
such
aura,
a loving environment,
and that's what's important when you go. Yeah. Like, you want to have fun and you want to meet people and you want to make friends.
I agree, Ann. Yes. I agree. That's why our theme this year is love and giving, because it's just that's what it's about there.
Well, I work the front gate, and I absolutely love to meet every single person that comes up. I always give them a smile, and I get to meet all the bands, so that is the best part. I love it. I just do. I love to be up there.
You're going to have
happy
a great view this
and
year,
smiling,
Lori.
And that's the way you need to be, right, when you're greeting people.
Yeah. You guys have to know. Yeah.
And then they
want to
be there because they see that you're excited that they're there, because I tell every single person that comes, we are so excited that you're here. We're happy to see you. And that helps them to feel better, because a lot of them look at me, and they're like, wow. Like, she's so happy to see us. And they will smile ear to ear because I'm nice to them when they come up. Because you know what I mean? You want them to feel loved.
Yep.
Make
yeah.
sure that they're loved and know that we want them there.
Yep.
Because they're coming to work hard for us so that we can get the show and do what we need to do. But they're there to help us. Everybody who comes in, from volunteers to the band members to whoever. I'm there to say, I'm so glad to see you.
Right on. Yeah. She starts out the experience.
That's beautiful.
It's an experience, right?
Plus, for me, like, I'm so excited about HempFest because we're going... We're going back to, like, our Mecca, our Holy Land. Like, for Porks, you know, Pork Fest, like, you know, and we're not going to, we're boycotting it this year. We've already talked about
I'm
it at AM. Oh, whatever. You're just disassociating. I'm boycotting. Same fucking difference. Who cares? I've moved on with my life. At any rate, last week, Rogers holds, like, a...
That's
Albert it holds
Walker.
A special place in our heart, you know? For those that haven't gone to Rogers before and are going to HempFest, you have no idea
it's
what's
awesome.
In store. The view there is majestic. You see the
tripping
white. You're in the middle of the White Mountains.
Is like a life-changing experience.
You guys need to know something. Last year, when you took your photographs up there of your engagement and just the whole scene of
there
it
was
all,
a double rainbow.
Just
like, what
so
the
you know,
fuck?
It touched
awesome
me.
Picture. You don't see that.
I honestly, yeah. I saw such like those beautiful, majestic views that were there. And I even asked Rob. I call him Rob, man. What's up with Rogers? Who should I talk to? Oh, talk to this person and talk to this one. And that's how we got to HempFest through Rob. You know that. Because of you guys doing your engagement, I fell in love with the place. And I told Tom. I said, Tom, he goes, no way. That place is too expensive, too big. And we're like, we'll work it out. God knows. You know, he's with us.
Well, I'm glad I can just at least point you in the right direction.
It
well,
worked,
it's
going
to
so.
Be awesome. And I feel like everything happens
awesome.
For a reason and leads you to, like, the right path as long as you
right.
have, like, positive energy going towards it.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I have so much positive energy just radiating. Like, even if it's just mine,
right.
it's, like, going to be
oh.
successful.
You know, you know awesome. Some of the other amazing things we have at HempFest this year is a pool.
There's a pool
a
there.
A water slide.
And a water slide.
We played in that
oh,
pool.
Oh, yeah, we were. Yeah,
we'll be frolicking. Yeah. There'll be a bunch of frolickers, you know, I'm sure of that.
You know, there's going
to
be
can't
live.
Can't wait to see Dimitri and Antron slide down that water slide. Those two are going to be hilarious.
We're going to have live glass blowing, a Mystic Arts Village.
What is that? Oh, just the art?
That's our art pavilion.
Village.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Nice. Also, yep. we're going to have acoustic bands playing alongside our art village this year,
oh,
serenading
that's so
the
nice.
Crowd. That's going to
wow.
be like,
I love acoustics.
I know. It's going to be phenomenal. We'll have them playing all night.
And some late night acoustic and VIP, too.
So,
oh.
HempFest
oh.
is.
Oh, hey, also.
People can come to HempFest on Thursday, correct? So, it's Thursday.
Thursday is a day you don't want to miss because Twiddle is playing Thursday night.
Right, but remember this, folks. Everybody remember, you got to pay for your Up and Smoke ticket, $75. $30 for the early bird, so it's $105 for your four-day pass for the limited time now. And then you're camping separate. It's $25 for up to four people per night. You figure that out and divide that, and you'll figure it out.
$5 per person added, so it works out to $10 to $12 a night.
And
to
how
camp.
Do people reserve their camping?
It's very cheap.
Through
Rogers.
Okay.
So are they, when Rogers you go through Rogers, are they assigning the spots, or?
Well, it's called allotment camping. That's how we do this. Remember, festivals are a little bit different than going to a campsite that has, you know, a spot. Hey, that's my campsite. Well, you can put five tents there.
Can I just say, because a lot of people have had misconceptions just asking me about Hempfest or Rogers and what to expect. This campground is deluxe. Like, we live like kings and queens. There is electricity at every campsite. There's actual bathrooms that they have.
Three bathrooms, hot showers.
You can park your car right beside your campsite.
Right. Well,
you can't get better than that. The views from one corner of your eye to the other.
Mountains.
It's a 100-mile view. Presidential range. The best views in all of New England. And then the views go behind you.
Yeah.
You know, they have a pool, water slide, which will be running for 2 days, shuffleboard, tennis courts.
Yep.
Not that you need all these amenities, but it's a destination. It really is. You can get lost there.
Yeah, people were just asking, like, oh, is this in the forest? Like, no, you need to know.
No, but we have a forest.
Rogers is, like, amazing. What you want for camping.
For those that don't know what it is.
It's the largest and best RV and campsite in New Hampshire.
If you go to youtube.com/rebel love show, I did a walkthrough with me and Rum Mistress here and a bunch of other people that have co-hosted the show and friends. We did a walkthrough video of like the last day of Porkfest. But regardless of the whole Porkfest thing, just watch that to see how beautiful Rogers is. If you want to get an idea of how beautiful it is.
Or just watch our engagement video too, because that was awesome.
Of course, engagement video.
And that really shows like the amazing views. And I don't know, like I look at Hempfest as a time that I want to go and I want to get enlightened. I'm getting married and it's going to be this whole new chapter of just the great things. And I want to share that with everyone, so make sure you buy your tickets.
And you got 1 week left, right?
One week
for the 3-day Up and Smoke early bird. $75 for 3 days, and then $30 for your Thursday early bird.
$30 early bird. Listen, we have to bring this up. Also, Pilativity Group, are one of our sponsors, is also working with vets. The VA are working with them directly now, and we would like veterans to come to New Hampshire Hempfest and Freedom Alley. Don't go online and pay for your ticket. Come to the gate. We're going to give you a 25% off the gate ticket when you arrive. Just show your ID and we'll know it's you. So please, anybody in the state of New Hampshire that has a family member that might need or post-traumatic or any type of anything that might want to be interested just in the concert to see what's going on, please bring yourselves out there. Experience what we're trying to share with the state so that everybody knows it's not about one, it's about many. Because that's what New Hampshire is. Out of many, we are one. So please, man, tell all the vets, let's all show up out there, man. It's a big deal to me.
Well, I'm definitely excited about it. Where can people go find tickets at? Where can they find you?
And where can they find New Hampshire Normal? And where can they find New Hampshire?
All your plugs.
Shameless self-promotions. Okay? You only got 1 minute. Everyone go.
You can
find the website at www.newhampshirehempfest.com for tickets and other information.
You can also go and find us on Facebook. New Hampshire Hempfest and Freedom Rally 2016. There's a lot of information there. We also support New Hampshire Normal, New Hampshire Cannabis Company, a newer New Hampshire. We support so many different groups and coalitions, the East Coast Cannabis Coalition. There are so many different groups for cannabis that we support in the state and support us. Laconia Fest also. Let's not forget them. And let's give a big round of applause to all of our volunteers this year, the hundreds of volunteers and
especially
the
Frank Federico, our volunteer
staff
chief.
Coordinator.
I call him the chief.
Our
but,
staff
you know,
coordinator, he, Frank Federico. Without him, we would have a lot of tough times. But Frankie, really thank you a lot. Emil Larrabee as well. Antron Riley, Tori Miner. There are so many people that we can't forget that are going to be there supporting us. Let's also give credence to Julie Gadeppi, our bake-off. Let's talk about Rob Robinson and his New York event. Harry Brown will be there. Cindy Ruggiero from New Jersey. Erica Goldler.
We want to go to one of his festivals. I've not gone
to one. Need to go to New York's event. It's one of the longest-running ones. It's a great event. He's got great music, and he's a great chap for the cause. He's been at this cause as long as we have. He's a good guy, Rob Robertson. Yes. Let's also talk about Doug Bledsoe. He'll be there.
Well, John.
I gotta ask you guys, is the magic bus gonna be there?
Well, we're heading out.
Enough of the food. All right,
of course the magic bus is coming.
All right.
Where can they find you, babe?
We're heading out. You can find my latest book on Amazon, iTunes, and...
Go to RebelLoveShow.com and HenFest.com. NHenFest.com. Peace, guys.